revelation going on in my soul.
Thank you, Kev Mo, for bringing us in with Stand Up and Be Strong. And from Chicago, it's Michael James and Katy Hogan with another edition of the Live from the Heartland show, known as the Heartland at Home during the time of the pandemic. This is number 81 for the week of December 18th. And we've got a couple of wonderful guests. We're going to talk about Evanston's first night celebration with Corky Siegel and Emily Guthrie. And we're going to have the thought poet Isaiah Very coming on and talking to us about an exhibit and what's going on in Inglewood. We're here every week and we question the actions of the rich and the powerful, and we try to give voice to the servants of the people who are trying to make a better world. Good morning to you, Katy.
Heavy duty claim. Hope we live up to it. I'm doing okay. I've been working until this week over at Gethsemane, and we sold enough trees that my winter season is now over. So I can concentrate on figuring out how we're doing holidays, this particular second COVID holiday season. Have you got any good news in your life, Michael?
Well, I had made plans to go to New York and I followed through on them, and I visited a lot of family. I visited children, grandchildren, my sister, my brother-in-law. I got to eat some oysters, got to be in the village, got to see my grandkids play soccer, picked up my granddaughter from her volleyball practice. It was a very busy 5 days and I had a great time, and I'm certainly glad to be back home in Chicago, and particularly in Rogers Park.
Well, okay. Hopefully we'll have actual, by the time this show comes on tomorrow morning, we'll have snow. But I don't think we're going to get it for
Christmas.
We're
not going to get it, I'll bet. I mean, yeah. I'm going to go to Weatherbug in a minute, but we'll see.
Don't bother. So worldwide, of course, there are always disasters. We won't cover all of them, but we were completely rocked by the devastation of Western Kentucky this week by an out of time tornado and out of place tornado that hovered for a couple of hours as it traveled over and really did some widespread destruction in Western Kentucky and also a couple other states, but they lost the most. There are people really lining up to help. They've gotten a lot of donations and people are, you know, donating blood and all that sort of thing, which we really recommend. I can't help but think, remember last year when Texas was really in bad straits and their power was out, and Ocasio-Cortez commandeered a couple million bucks to send to Texas. And these small donations that are going into Kentucky, I'm sure are coming from red and blue states. I hope that the voters in Kentucky and Texas remember who helped them out. Really, really tragic though. Once again, Haiti, which we've covered a little bit this year, with the overturned truck carrying fuel, the desperation of people running to collect the spilled fuel, even as the flames were rising around them. This is a picture of what's wrong with the world right now. Closer to
home. On the national front, our Congress is still at work trying to get the Build Back Better bill passed before the holiday break. Manchin and Sinema are still seemingly problematic. But what did go through without a lot of fanfare and announcement to the people, a far larger amount of money than the stimulus and the Build Back Better, is the Defense Act, with a lot of new money for the military. They actually, in the bill, they passed it for more money than was even requested. Really interesting where the priorities seem to lie, even among people who we like to think are doing well for us in Congress.
It's too true. Yeah, too true. Speaking of national figures, we reached a new water point. 800,000 deaths this week in the U.S. from COVID, and they are climbing again. All indicators are that it's still going to get worse before it gets better. We can only encourage people to get your shots and your booster or stay at home. If you don't want to be taking shots, then you got to stay out of harm's way because you're going to get sick. And that's the indicator that's going on now, no matter what your belief system is about vaccinations. Anyway,
on the labor front,
report, Michael.
Yeah, on the labor front, we've been trying to keep you up abreast of the kind of resurgence in strikes and organized labor's activities. We've talked about the Kellogg strike. First, we said that a contract had been approved, and last week we announced that it had been rejected by the workers. Apparently, there is a new contract. A vote was taken on Thursday. We'll know on Tuesday, but it looks like the Kellogg workers are going back to work, and you'll be able to eat your favorite crispy breakfast cereals. Out in Huntington Beach, California, the city council declared a local emergency in response to an ongoing labor dispute with its waste hauler and its employees. And over in Reno, Nevada, union for drivers and the operator of the Metro Reno's transit system say they've reached a tentative agreement to settle a contract dispute that dramatically reduced service during the past 3 weeks. These are only a few of the strikes that are going on around the country. We'll try to keep you abreast and bring on some labor experts in the not too far off.
Okay, briefly, Illinois politics, the head of Dark Money Group that helped defeat last year's graduated income tax measure is behind a campaign to elect a Republican candidate to run against J.B. Pritzker in 2022. And the money behind this effort will come from none other than billionaire Ken Griffin. Keep your eye on this space, we'll keep you posted. On the Democratic side, we heard that the Cook County Democratic Party is actually asking for a signed loyalty oath from slated candidates.
What kind of loyalty oath? Is that a loyalty to the country, to the party?
No, it's a loyalty to the slate. It's meaning you won't go for any other candidate who might be running for judge or whatever. To me, it smacks of machine era tactics, and it's ridiculous. Okay, we're running out of time here.
Well, real quickly, over here in Chicago, New City reports that a new outdoor skating rink, roller skating rink, that is to be built in West Garfield Park. And also, we just got word that the city's libraries will once again be open 7 days a week.
You are listening to Live from the Heartland, WLUW 88.7 FM. Stay tuned. We'll be right back with First Night Evanston's Emily Guthrie and our friend Corky Siegel. Hey, welcome aboard, you two. Glad to have Corky Siegel and Emily Guthrie, who are working together again to create this one-of-a-kind celebration on New Year's Eve called First Night, which marks Evanston's 25th celebration. Let's start. Can you tell us, Emily, how Evanston became the most notable local venue for First Night, something that originated in Boston back in 87, I think?
Oh, I think it's giving us a lot of credit to call us most notable, but we have managed to weather an economic downturn and the pandemic. So yeah, we're still here. We started in 92 when Annie Heidemann brought the idea from Boston. And the year of the millennium, I think, was our highlight. We had 15,000 people attend. We took, we asked for zip codes, and we had 72 zip codes represented that year. And we were at 40 different locations, started at noon and ran until midnight. And, you know, it's just a whole lot of fun. It gives you a place, you can stay in town, you can go get a good meal somewhere, park your car, everything's located right next to the downtown. So you can head out after dinner and go to any one of a number of places. This year, of course, and last year, we're going to be virtual. So we're letting people know they can stay home, stay comfortable, stay safe, stay warm, get their favorite meal, their favorite beverage, and sit down at 9:45 and enjoy the show. And then that'll be followed by a live chat on Zoom. It should be another great evening.
My understanding is that Corky has been wrangled into being the wrangler for the talent. And it looks like from the poster that I got a glimpse of that you've done quite a good job. Do you want to give us a little bit of a hint as to who we might expect to hear in the talent world up there on Evanston's First Night?
Yeah. Emily could help me with this. But, you know, it was really a team effort. This was curated by Emily and me and Steve Haugier. Actually, I think the three of us pretty much curated it. And some of the people are, let's see, I'll go off the top of my head here. Wayne Baker Brooks is going to share his new hit single. The Sons of Blues with Billy Branch has this amazing piece. Alvie Ray Smith, who is the co-founder of Pixar, and was with Steve Jobs. And he wrote the code for Toy Story.
And he's an artist performing on your...
Yeah. What he's doing is he's talking about Moore's Law and the computer revolution, because he just wrote a book called The Biography of the Pixel, which is all about the computer revolution. And he's going to talk about that. Then we're going to play a little 3-minute experimental video he made in 1979 with Ed Emshweller, who you may have seen if you looked at all the science fiction magazines from the 50s. He was the artist.
Can't say I did, but.
And then.
Well, I'm going to now.
Yeah. And then he's going to talk about how Toy Story was almost not made, and how it finally was made, and how the digital revolution had to do with it. It's amazing and fun.
Wow.
So, you know, we got a lot of diversity in there. And we got Michael Smith, you know, the late songwriter Michael Smith.
The late great.
Yeah, just he's singing this amazing song he wrote along with the puppeteer Blair Thomas, international known puppeteer. And they're doing this excerpts from the piece called Selfish Giant. Steve Haugier, when he was reviewing the whole 2 hour and 22 minute work of First Night for First Night's New Year's Eve celebration, he had to watch that twice. And within the piece itself, it's already played twice because I couldn't bear to just play it once. So there's two versions of it where you could hear this song twice, and Steve took that and had to listen to it twice. It's quite amazing. And John Primer, has a piece called Poor Man Blues, which is just incredible. And Sons of the Never Wrong. I don't know, you know those guys.
Oh, sure.
Yeah, they used to play the Heartland.
Yep.
Yeah, they're doing three pieces. And so, I don't know if you know Dorothy Scott, we call her the Princess of Preemptive Peace, is doing two works. I'm doing a few of them. I know I'm leaving some amazing people out. Could you
Lynn
think?
Jordan.
Lynn Jordan is singing the Auld Lang Syne, and Ernie Watts, the jazz saxophone player, a two-time Grammy Award winner, is joining us on Auld Lang Syne. And by the way, Alvy Ray Smith, who I mentioned, won two Academy Awards for his works. So let's see, what else, Emily?
Oh, I don't know, I've written checks and I don't can't remember all the names.
Let me ask you this, Emily, given that you're for the second year, this will be a virtual celebration. In the past, when you described some of these events that have been, you know, multiple venues and notable individual experiences across the entire day, how well do you feel you guys did last year when you did your first virtual version? Because everyone's been learning under this COVID thing,
right?
How to do anything, including us doing our radio show the way we are right here. But I liked when I heard Corky use the word curated when describing the work that he and Holly and others did putting together this big tape. How do you feel about that, Emily, given that your long experience being the Veep of Evanston first night?
Well, last night was an experiment, but it felt like it was necessary not to even try and do it live. And the
last year,
right? Yeah, we used Eventbrite to help sell tickets, and they capped us at 1,000 people. And we regularly were right up at 1,000. And then it would drop down to like 920. I think people were wandering around among different things. I think almost everybody was virtual last year. I don't remember anybody trying to do it live.
Right.
And so this year, because we're using mandolin for the reservations, we're not calling them tickets because we're not asking for a fixed price. We're asking people to contribute what they think it's worth to have more than 2 hours of live performances by more than 20 artists. They can find that at Mandolin, or they can find it at our website, which is firstnightevanston.org. So this year we're not capped at 1,000. So we're gonna be real interested to see, you know, if the numbers really bounce up. Mandolin has a contacts list of almost 200,000 people. So we're hoping this will just be gangbusters. And then, you know, fingers crossed, next year we can go live. That's our hope.
Seriously.
We'll see.
Go ahead, Michael. Michael, you're on mute.
And by the way, Al Day is another of the performers.
Oh,
with,
good.
Poetry slammer, Smith.
Mark.
Mark Smith, yeah.
Yeah. Go ahead, Michael.
Well, speaking of virtual, I have the big question I have, and I've been waiting to ask this. How do you do virtual fireworks?
Oh, we do them. We've got them.
Yeah.
We've got them. That's quirky.
These fireworks that Holly and I used are from Germany in many years ago when explosions were outside our hotel window when we were playing with all these symphony orchestras in Germany. And we just ran with our iPhone to the window and filmed it. And that's what we're using in this film.
Really?
See the people shooting them off right below our window.
Okay, Emily, I got to tell you that your face is not totally in the picture right now. And I want to ask you a question.
I was pouring my tea.
Look at you.
I'm going to have me a little coffee.
We're very casual here. I've got my coffee, but it's cold. So, Emily, you mentioned that there is a bit that follows the singing of Auld Lang Syne, which will be led by Lynn Jordan, I guess. And that little bit after features live back and forth with Corky and other artists. Can you talk about that a bit?
Yeah, it's going to be a Zoom call that'll be available to everybody. Corky and Lynn just did a concert at the Levy Center here in Evanston, and they had 100 people on their Zoom call. So we have no idea, and I get to manage it. So I've been practicing managing Zoom calls. We have no idea, but they went, you and Lynn went almost an hour, Porky. You were having so much fun with your back and forth.
Yeah.
You know, it was very free and loose and really enjoyable. They were kidding each other about stuff and going on. So yeah, that'll be a little bit of a bonus. The other thing we should mention is that the show is going to be available for 48 hours afterward.
Ah.
So if people miss it that night, or if like Porky, they want to see that one piece again, they'll be able to go to it, back it up and watch it enough times that they can figure out exactly what was going on in that piece.
And if people sign up on the way that they do, which you can tell us how they do that, then they have the ability to check that out afterwards for those 48 hours?
Yeah.
Anybody can afterward, yeah.
Anybody can.
Right.
Do they have to go to Mandolin to find it, or do they go to First Night?
I think after the show, Corky, don't they go to YouTube?
No, they're going to go to my own Zoom link, to my Zoom account.
Okay.
No, not for the whole show, afterward.
Yeah, afterwards, it's the Zoom is just, it'll
no,
be
I'm talking part. About the Zoom, I'm talking about the whole show.
Oh, yeah. Two hours. No, it's not on YouTube, it's on Mandolin.
Oh, it is. Okay. But they can find it. Mandolin. It's just mandolin. mandolin.com. Right.
Oh, yeah. That was new to me, finding out about that. Go ahead, Michael.
I was going to ask about how this is organized. Is it a private thing that works with the city? Is the city take initiative? Evanston is our wonderful neighbor town to the north, or city to the north. There's a lot of wonderful things about it that I could share. I love the YMCA, et cetera. But I'm just wondering if you could talk a little bit about the city spirit. You got a new mayor up there, Daniel Biss. What's going on in Evanston, even though Porky, I know, lives in Chicago?
Suburb of Evanston.
Well, Evanston's never quiet. There's always at least a half a dozen issues that people are working on. But yeah, we get tremendous support. We've got corporate sponsors. And a lot of them have been with us almost from the beginning. We used to get state and city funding. We no longer do that. It's all private. And that helps us keep the price down. This would cost, 2 hours of live performances would probably cost at least $100 per person.
Right.
And we're asking for 35, and that could be an entire household. So it could be two people, it could be 16 people if people want to get together. But we get the local support that we get from residents. The year 2013, when we brought it back for Evanston's 150th anniversary, and we had 6 inches of snow on the ground at 6 o'clock, I figured we were just dead in the water, and we had 3,000 people. And I said to somebody a couple of weeks later that I had been afraid that we weren't gonna have anybody show up. And she said, ordinarily we go out to Arlington Heights. We've done that for years. But when we saw the weather, we said, we don't need to do that. We can stay right here in town and go to First Night. So I think our numbers, I thought they would be depressed by the weather. I think maybe they actually were increased by the bad weather that year.
And speaking of the weather, if we stop doing these, what we call virtual shows, actually I call them closer than in-person shows, people are going to miss them because you don't have to worry about the weather. You could wear your pajamas. You could go to the kitchen for your dinner or for snacks, and you're not going to disturb anyone. You could have your pets, your kids, and you get to see you get a front row seat. Everyone gets a front row seat, even more than a front row seat. You get to be on stage with some of the performers and watch their hands on the keyboards. When could you do that in a live performance?
Built in a bathroom break.
But you do have to be careful if you're doing the Zoom from home. Remember that reporter who got caught with his pants down.
Right. Right, exactly. But in terms of all of that, you don't have to wear a mask. You don't have to do anti-social distancing.
Corky, you did a lot of shows during using the COVID protocol and Zoom, right? I caught a couple of them.
As soon as March 2020 turned around and we ended up here in Chicago, I immediately purchased a FileMaker Pro and had to start learning how to become a video filmmaker.
Yeah.
And I spent my whole year calling Apple three times a week and getting assistance and just learning how to do it, because I realize now musicians have to know how to do this.
Yeah. Well, we all, it was a learning curve for everyone. As we started this is our 80th.
Learning curve ball.
Yes, learning curve ball. This is our
80th, having a ball, baby.
81st Zoom show for us. And I'm still learning. And as we came on today, I said to Michael, I got to learn how to blur the background, you know, because you can do that in Zoom. And I still haven't, you know, taken the time in between shows to figure it out. And I know it's easy, but, you know, us old people. Okay, let's remind people how to find First Night Evanston and be part of a great New Year's celebration.
And what day and that is too.
We have a website, firstnightevanston.org. And through us, you can go to, we've got lots of Facebook pages, and you can go to Mandolin. Any one of those places will get you to where you can make a reservation.
Yeah. Great. Even on my page, quirkymusic.com. mandolin.com, firstnightevanston.org, right?
Right, we're an org.
Any of those places.
Well, you two, congratulations on your great collaboration. And we'll probably see you on New Year's Eve or be part of that faceless bunch out there in the virtual world. But
you
thank
won't,
you for your commitment.
You will not want to miss it. It is like... Every time I see the next little section, I go, oh my God, I love this. Every single one. Oh, I love this one. Oh, I love this one. Oh, I love this one. You know, it's like unbelievable. It's unbelievable.
Well, I thank you in advance for giving us all something to do on New Year's Eve.
That's safe and healthy.
Yeah, that's exactly. So bless you both. And everyone can enjoy this little
Yes, trailer. Thank you, Katy. And thank you, Michael.
Yes.
For the kitties, real life dreamers in the suburbs and the cities, riding around town, windows up, steaming, beaming, singing along to it in the cut, heavy streaming. Mama don't know what a little nigga feeling. Daddy been gone, and my brother stay tripping. For every little homie that's lonely, this is all for you. Give a fuck about the phony. All in the plan, as you grow, make the moments last. Even though life is some shit, moves fast. Cold in the realest, hands high, feel this. Spoken to the head, but remember, shit's vicious. Never lose hope if you don't, you be golden. Always keep your family close, keep your heart open. To the chosen, so dollar rolling.
This is just the right vibe. Turn it loud if you need to. Stars in the sky, they will light your way through. Feeling alone, just know you are not. We won't leave you alone. This is just the right vibe. Turn it loud if you need to. Stars in the sky, they will light your way.
Passing little tides, seeing what I'm seeing, the pain I will write. Yeah, ooh, we're chosen in the night. Thinking with a vision, I'll become a different wish. Yeah, I know, well, dreaming in the mission now. Things are getting better, waiting my whole life. Oh, my, 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 my.
This is just the right vibe. Turn it loud if you need to. Stars in the sky, they will light the way through. Feeling alone, just know you are not. We won't leave you alone.
Hey, hey. So Isaiah's in the house. Thank you for joining us, Isaiah Vinay. Yay. We got to know you thanks to our co-producer, Lynn Orman Weiss. You are a writer, photographer, poet. Let's start by tell to us, what is the meaning of thought poet?
I think the simplest way to answer that is I grew up on the south side of Chicago. I was born out west, raised out south. And I went to what people will call a typical CPS school.
Which one?
And so, you know, there wasn't a lot. So I actually went to Burnside Scholastic Academy. And so it wasn't the best, but it also wasn't the worst. And so, you know, a CPS school, a lot of times they don't have resources, you know, for programs and stuff like that. And so, interestingly enough, my grandma, she was very artistic when I was growing up. So she always had me like art fairs and stuff like that. And so she's the one who pushed me into, you know, kind of being consistent with poetry. And so when I thought it was cool again, I kind of started like playing with words and stuff like that. And and this is like during the Facebook era. And so it was actually thought poetic. And as I, you know, started being a writer and I started doing more organizing work, it kind of shortened to thought poet. And now it's thought poet's opinion. So.
Very nice.
We're going to be asking you about your photography a little bit. Why don't you share with us how you got interested in doing photography and how do you utilize that
to
better the community?
For sure. So to be honest with you, I didn't really have a choice. If I'm being honest, like I said, my grandma, she was a very artistic person. She's a doll maker, painter, sculptor. And I wasn't raised by my biological parents. I was raised with my grandmother. And so she basically had my nose in a Gordon Parks book or some type of like, you know, Black literature when we were growing up. So me and my three my two siblings, we actually were kind of like, I guess, woke before it was like cool or whatever. So like, you know, growing up, you know, especially growing up in Chatham at Tule Park, we weren't always like celebrated for, you know, having all this knowledge about, you know, who Dusabo was and, you know, kind of knowing about like all this art stuff. And so, you know, I ran away from it for a while. And so, you know, in high school, I started doing like after school matter programs. And so that kind of led me to True Star Magazine. And, you know, that's what kind of led me to doing more music journalism. But the art was always there. The photography was always there. I was always taking photos of concerts I was like covering and stuff like that. And so when I finally stopped running this music blog called The Lyrical Lab, it kind of forced me to kind of just like finally step into, I guess some people call it my calling. And it really forced me to like really just start focusing on me. And so I had always been around a camera. I was using my phone. My grandma bought my first actual camera before it got stolen. And so I just kind of always was around it. And like I said, my grandma had us around a lot of art when we were coming up. And so she just had me around this very type of energy where like, you know, the way that I write and the way that I carry my work is very Chicago, you know what I'm saying? And it's a certain type of Chicago that many people won't experience unless they've actually gone to these spaces, into these communities. And that's, I believe, is probably the most special thing, is that it's just a very authentic, like energy around my photography and writing because it has a very authentic Chicago feel to it. So shout out to my grandma.
Isaiah, let me ask you something. And Michael, take yourself off mute, please. Your current exhibit is taking place at something called SFFB Gallery. tell us what that stands for and if it's a movable feast. And if it is, where is it being located right now, that cafe? Tell us about that.
Yeah, so that's actually an acronym for Sanctuary from Forgotten Blocks. And so the name actually came from me, always living, like I said, like I've lived on the south side of Chicago pretty much my entire life. I've lived in different spots, but the south side has always been my home. And so once again, like I was saying before, when it comes to the feeling that comes with my photos, like most people won't recognize what that feeling is unless you're living in these communities. You know what I'm saying? So unless you're living in Inglewood, unless you're living in Chatham, Arbor Gresham, Roseland, like you won't be able to truly experience Black and Brown lives and how they take up these spaces. You know what I'm saying? Like these people have lived here for decades. You know what I'm saying? Like these are like people that have literally changed how Chicago is like cultivated, you know what I'm saying? You know, since the migration. And so Sanctuary for Forgotten Blocks is really just showing the beauty and also the sadness that comes with looking at impoverished communities throughout Chicago. And so this particular series is at Kusani Cafe, which is in Inglewood, and the photos actually focus on Inglewood. And so when I say that, most of the time when people talk about Inglewood or West Inglewood or Greater Inglewood, they always try to connect violence or they try to connect, you know, lack of resources or the fact that police over police in this community. And that's all true. I'm not getting away from any of that, but there's so much history and culture and beauty and wisdom that lies in these communities. And literally just going to these events and volunteering or just like going to, you know, talk to these people that are at these events in Inglewood, you'll get a chance to see that. And this photo series, it's an ongoing photo series that you can actually see on Instagram or at the cafe. But it just really entails that, because I think a lot of people are always forgetting that these Black and Brown people are still fighting to exist. You know what I mean? So when there's no cameras being shown saying like this happened in Chicago or, you know, whatever like that, these people are fighting every day to exist. You know what I'm saying? And so these stories are very special because these stories are happening even after this interview is over with. So, yeah.
Tell us one more time where the current version of the Sanctuary from Forgotten Blocks is being shown and how long is it there and what are the hours? Because they were I think late afternoon to early evening through, give us the dates and times.
Yes. Congrats. So I'm bringing it up on my phone really quick, but it's at Kusanya Cafe. And like I said, that's right in the heart of Inglewood. It's a very amazing establishment that basically has a lot of just like dope people coming through there, but it's in the morning. The address is 825 West 69th. And it's normally open from like 8 a.m. to I think maybe like 2 or 3 or something like that. But it's going to be up until February. And yeah, all of the photos are also on sale. If folks want to go and buy one, you can definitely put in to buy a piece. All of the monies are going to the organizations, Good Kids, Mad City and Her Chicago. Both these organizations do a lot of work around like mutual aid, trying to get mental health resources to the community and stuff like that. So,
you know, you talk a lot about organizing and you did talk about a friend of yours and I'm blocking his name, Malik Alim.
Yeah.
And, tell us a little bit about his work and was he, I'm assuming he was a mentor to you or someone you looked to and you developed your photography. Fill me in or correct me and share some information.
So, I'll put it like this. Malik Alim was someone that is very special to the Chicago community in this very moment. Like he, what he did as far as organizing, what he did as far as just trying to be a cis hetero Black man that's learning and unlearning how to be less toxic and misogynistic to Black women. He was amazing in just existing, right? And so I'm gonna try not to get emotional, but Malik
okay,
was actually-
Okay, it's happened here before, so.
let it roll.
Yeah. sorry.
God love you.
Yes, all right.
Nothing to be sorry about. I know we were part of the effort to get a bail-free city. And I think that was one of his major works, right?
Yeah. And the funny thing is that was actually one of the very few things he was acknowledged for. He did a lot of work with the Say Her Name campaign, the Buy Anita Alvarez campaign. He did a lot of work with organizations like Black Youth Project 100 and the Let Us Breathe Collective. And he was one of the very few people that really believed in my work. In 2016, he was one of the people who actually pushed me to have my very first photo exhibit. And mind you, the organizing community, it's powerful, but people can be overlooked, and the ability to just exist is hard because a lot of the times we don't often treat people the same way that we claim we do. Like we talk about restorative and transformative justice, but sometimes we don't often act out those things. And Malik was very important in holding a lot of people accountable that have done harms to other people in this community. And he taught me, he taught me how to exist in this city and doing this organizing work, because it's not easy. It's not easy. You're dealing with real people's lives. You're fighting to be heard, because at the end of the day, Black and brown people are heard at all. You know what I'm saying? And all they're asking for is resources to exist in the communities that we've lived and been grown up in. You know what I'm saying? And so Malik, I would say he was probably one of the most incredible people that I know. To this day, he still has not received the affirmations that he should have received when he was here. But I owe a lot to him as far as even me being where I am right now. I would say he was my big brother. He was definitely a mentor, but I would definitely say that was my big brother for sure.
Well, that's good to hear. I'd like to know more about him. I read a piece about you in, I think, Tribe, and you did talk about organizing, and both Katy and I come out of organizing experiences. I worked in Uptown with poor and working whites and well as Blacks and Latinos. And and you point out in that article how you don't always get credit for what you do and you don't always receive the results. Organizing is an ongoing process. You really, to bring about social change and economic and political change, people really have to grind away at it for a long time. And sometimes it feels like you don't get a lot of return. And at other times it just blossoms. And I wondered if you wanted to share any other kind of organizing work that you are doing in the community. You did talk about a demonstration at City Hall. Just share a little bit more about the kind of work you do.
Yeah. So like I said before, I've done a lot of organizing, just like with Malik, with the Let Us Breathe Collective, Black Youth Project 100, the list goes on. Myself and Malik were really pivotal in a lot of the organizing that took place last year, and really in the last 5 years, when it came to the protest that lashed out because of what happened to Breonna Taylor and George Floyd. And I was also one of the organizers that was arrested like the second day in Hyde Park. And it was interesting because it was a lot of mess around that situation because no one knew that I even got arrested for like almost 24 hours and stuff like that. And
that's scary.
It was. And I don't think people understand how the processing that, how hard that is. But because of the works of, again, like folks from Good Kids, Mad City, organizations like Nita's Love Train, Asada's Daughters, we were able to do a really monumental protest called Break the Piggy Bank at the end of 2020. And it actually was named like one of the best demonstrations of what we were advocating for in the year 2020. And I led it. And I just to this very day, I'm still processing what that even means because it's like, we don't do this for show. We don't do this, you know what I'm saying, to necessarily give a congratulations. We're doing this to make it be known that we're fighting for people that have not been able to fight for themselves. And the organizing that we do, like it goes from mutual aid. So, you know, running up a lot of these Black and Brown youth GoFundMes or mutual aids that are on social media, you know, going into the communities and just passing out like actual like groceries, you know what I'm saying? Because there's like so many food deserts in these communities, like actually getting a nutritious meal in a 24 hour period is not possible. Like the organizing we do is hard. It is extremely hard. And that's again why I'm even appreciative that y'all are, you know, talking to me about it, because, you know, it is difficult. But I would say my work as an organizer, it's evolved me just as much as, you know, I've been able to do the work. And like I said, because I'm a photographer in my work, like literally within the past 5 years, I can show you photos from a lot of these protests that have taken place. But the goal is, again, for us to actually make change in, you know, this city. You know what I'm saying? Like, we have a mayor that's in seat right now that does nothing for the community and does their very best to make sure that they ignore the pleas that are being put out to better community. You know what I mean? Like, you have a individual, Mohawk Johnson, that's been on like severe house arrest since he was arrested in 2020. And literally, like, the mayor, like the city, they could like destroy this bond the Chicago Police Department has on his life right now, and they choose not to do so. You know what I'm saying? Yeah, a lot of this organizing deals with real lives, you know what I'm saying? And so, you know, like I said, when the cameras are done and the articles are done, like, we still are doing the work. So let
me just say, Isaiah, it's so wonderful to hear you talk the way you just did. Like Michael said, we've been organizing, we've been doing a lot of anti-racist organizing for 50 years, basically, between the two of us, because we're old. So we are thrilled to have in front of us the work that you've been part of for the last couple of years, specifically the growth of the Black Lives Matter movement that means so much globally. So I just want to say, you know, we never get pats on the back when we need them the most for doing the hard work, but you should pat yourself on the back for both of us, because we're thrilled with what you're doing. And one other piece of education you can provide our listeners, talk to us about what is ShotSpotter and the Stop ShotSpotter campaign. Right out here on my block, we've got posters on the wall saying Stop ShotSpotter. And so I think a lot of people don't know what it is. Do you mind explaining that?
Yeah, I'm really glad you brought that up, because the campaign is basically it's going on to help cancel a contract for a surveillance program that's pretty much on the south and west sides of Chicago only. And the whole point of the program is to bring more awareness to like gunshots that are supposedly going off in like the different parts of the community. So you have between 25 at sometimes 40 different like devices that are on like different light poles throughout like entire South and West Side communities. And again, this program is worth about $33+ million. The program actually doesn't even work. Like the program actually is so faulty that a lot of the times when the police are sent off to like, you know, look at different dispatches and, you know, alerts, majority of the time it's like reacting to like really like closed, like when people like slam their car doors or something like that. Or like, you know, if kids are like lighting fireworks, like simple stuff, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
You know, because police are already over violent and they already over police these communities, that's how a lot of these situations where, you know, police, again, basically become extremely violent. That's how a lot of these things happen. And so, again, this program, they had a contract, like a contract review that they were supposed to do in the public. They wound up just renewing the entire contract behind closed doors and not letting the public even know about it. So in layman's terms, it really sucks. And so the campaign is basically folks trying to advocate to get the contract canceled and to have those funds put into actual community organizations that are actually doing the work to actually make communities safe. You know what I'm saying? Because people always want to talk about gun violence and gun violence this. And, you know, the funny thing is, if you were actually like, and I don't know if people think about this, but in the past like year and a half, or better yet, I'll say this, right? This contract, like I said, is worth $33 million. If you take that entire $33 million and just put $1.2 million in Chicago Park District programs, After School Matter programs, trade programs, like if you just put that, I mean, and I mean, literally do like a 6 month review, right? Where, you know, you like, you know, have people show where all the money went and all that stuff. I promise you, in a five-year time period, you would see how quickly communities are benefiting from that money. You
know, yes, what I mean? My brother. Yes.
So, yeah, that's basically in a nutshell what the campaign is. It's frustrating. Yeah,
we love having you here. Thank you so much. We've run through our time, but Michael, did you have one? You wanted him to repeat the gallery.
I just want you to tell us the name of the cafe, the name of your exhibit, and when people can see it. It runs until early February.
February 3rd.
Give us the address.
Yeah. So again, it's going to be at Kusanya Cafe. The address is 825 West 69th. Again, it's going to be going into February. The hours you can go are between like 8 a.m. To like 3 or 4. And I'm also working on putting out another body of work in the new year. So I'm going to be announcing the flyer and all that stuff on social media.
Yeah, and that's going to be at the Hideout, right?
Yeah. It's going to be at the Legendary Hideout. And so that'll be a gallery / performance / panel discussion.
I want to know when that happens. You got to tell us.
Yeah. It's going to happen January 14th. Like I said, we're getting details together now. And I can tell you the conversations are going to be about what would life in Chicago look like without police. And the imagery, the videos, the conversations, it's going to be a really good time. So
sweet.
Nice to meet you, brother.
Thank you so much.
Thank you all so much for having me.
A real treat to meet you, sir.
Thank you all so much for listening to Live from the Heartland. We want to wish you all a very Merry Christmas and Happy Holidays, and we will see you all back in 2 weeks for the New Year's Day episode.
Wow, what a beautiful guy to have on. Oh my gosh.
The thought poet.
Yeah.
Isaiah Renee.
Hey, do you have any brief sports page for us real quick?
Just that COVID is rampant. People are having to do the COVID protocols. Games are canceled. Stay tuned. There may not be a lot of football to be watching on during the holidays. We'll see. Basketball too. The Bulls had two games canceled.
And in memoriam, unfortunately this week, a friend, a dear friend and local artist who really made it big during the last presidency because he is an excellent political cartoonist, and that is young Keith Taylor. Recently got famous because he became the cartoonist of request during the Trump administration, and the Chicago Public Square had him as their chief illustrator. Peace and blessings, Keith. You were a beautiful human being. We're going to go out with Our World by Twin Peaks. This is our 81st Heartland at Home show. And for over 25 years, we've brought you live from the Heartland, now Heartland at Home, broadcast every Saturday morning at 9 a.m., streaming live on WLUW.org. You can also catch us at youtube.com/heartlandmedia. There's a million of our shows up there. And every once in a while, we're cablecast on CAN TV, Channel 27. We thank our team and all of you for listening. Do good in the world.
The world needs all the good that we do and that you do.
All power to the people.
To the people.
Still